First of all, I want to welcome you to the first ever Asian Longhorned Beetle certification program for green industry professionals. We have a lot of material to cover. There's some brand new things happening. For example, the handout that you got, the package that you got has a new offering, a new opportunity we're going to cover at the end. So without further ado, let's just get started. The first thing I want to cover is partnership, because everything about Asian Longhorned Beetle from the beginning to the end has been a series of partnerships. We're about education. We are not regulatory. USDA APHIS, regulatory. And of course, as you very well know, the Ohio Department of Agriculture, regulatory. It's helpful sometimes to have these regulatory educator partnerships because it allows us then to pursue some of the educational venues that may not be as appropriate if you are enforcing a law. Another really nice connection that's gone on for quite some time is with the Ohio Department of Natural Resources, particularly Division of Forestry. So if we go to their website, there's the Division of Forestry's website. We go a little further to forestry assistance, as you can see, private landowner, urban forester, forest industries, and then in particular, urban forestry. Very important, Division of Forestry, urban forestry has been involved with tree replacement initiatives, both for emerald ash borer and then in the future with Asian longhorned beetle. In fact, the future is kind of bright. We've also had quite a few programs that you're very well aware of, programs that varying degrees of partnerships in terms of multiple locations. Green industry updates. You know, many of you have been to previous green industry updates. As a matter of fact, if we go back over a year ago, Asian longhorned beetle was announced to be here in Ohio. The announcement was made on June 17th last year. On the 23rd, we held a gathering at the Claremont County Extension Office for updates to the green industry. Had about 120 people. September 2nd, this was, I thought, one of the neatest ones, this field training. And then on January 9th, 180 that was held at one of the Hamilton County parks. So we have had updates. This field training, we are very pleased with. You can see these are infested trees in the Bethel area. We were able to take down two trees, dissect them. I got to wear a really neat helmet. So the people could see firsthand what to look for. And OSU Extension has had a number of outreach endeavors as well. And Amy did this survey as of March the 1st, 2012. So again, it's a bit dated. But we surveyed just Extension in Ohio, our colleagues. How many training events are you having? 79 respondent, 207 training programs by Extension throughout Ohio, reaching over 10,000 individuals. So we have had training. We've also had published articles in the Buckeye Arborist and also in the Tree Care Industry magazine. So we've done those things. They've been primarily updates, what's happening, what do we know today. But what we've never done is we've never had a gathering where we've had two overarching goals. Number one, coming out of the training with a certificate so that you can say that you have had this training rather than just, okay, we got together, we talked about ALB. That's important for companies, in my opinion, in our opinion, that recognition. Also, your names will be recognized by USDA APHIS as having gone through this training. And that's going to pay off here in just a little bit. We'll get to that. So what's different between all that other training and the training we're doing today? Well, the big difference is the standardized curriculum and focus on professionals who work with trees. I want to show you the curriculum committee for today's program. And I have to tell you, I think it's pretty darn impressive. When you go down the list and you look at people who have had input on what you're about to learn today and the makeup of the program today, which also includes viewers like you. Yes, I watch PBS, always like that. And that is that around the room, you may or may not know this, that there are selected practitioners involved in today's curriculum. That's different. Armed professionals with knowledge they can apply, and this is the other big difference. In fact, the packet you have is focused primarily on this. The packet you have is partially for your own edification, for your own educational purposes, but we do hope from here on out you help us, you help all of us, to to be educators, that you do the outreach as well. In other words, and that they can pass on to their customers or citizens. That's very important. Some of the previous information was primarily, okay, let's discuss what you need to look for and da-da-da. This is to say, okay, trained eyes looking for ALB, and you're going to help us with producing more trained eyes. The overarching goal for today, through this training, to detect, and I want to say this very deliberately, to detect any previously undetected ALB infestations. Now, is this saying that we are certain there are undetected ALB infestations? No. But we, I think, in this room would all agree that if there is, the faster we find them, the faster that they can be eradicated. Speed is important. Speed of detection equals speed of eradication. So from this room, then, you can go out and say, I now feel a little more confident, hopefully, with helping us with this. So where'd it come from? It's native to Eastern Asia. Asian longhorned beetle is not a native of Japan. It's native of China and the Koreas. How to get here? We'll just use your imagination. And the fact is, those crates, those containers get put right on trucks, they get put right on trains, they get shipped throughout the United States. And then it disperses and spreads under two different methods. One's natural spread. This is common sense. And natural spread is fired based on proximity of infested trees, common sense, right? Heavily infested trees, close to non-infested, well, the spread's going to be pretty easy, right there, right across the way. And population density. No point in leaving a tree if there's plenty of food left, right? When populations get high, then it can spread that way. This is what we really worry about. Obviously, we worry about this, but this part can be predicted. This part is hard to predict. Human assisted spread. Now, if you go over to the Bethel area, if you go in the regulated zone, I was actually very surprised the first visit I made. One of the USDA APHIS people there, Stefan, I can't remember his last name. When I pulled up, I had the PT Cruiser out there, had the back open, windows down, and he said, you know, Joe, you're going to have to look through your car before you leave. And at first, I mean, you know, not that I joke a lot, but I kind of thought he was, you know, I thought, oh, he's a good guy. No, he was dead serious, because they can hitchhike. Now, in my head, I was thinking, this is a big beetle. I'd probably see it sitting in the passenger seat. I'm telling you, though, if you go over there, pay attention. Pay attention to your vehicles. You don't believe me? Look at this, going down right here, hitchhiking, going down 75. You have infested tree trimmings that can be moved. And again, this really gets into the compliance training later in terms of what not to do, what to be aware of. And of course, things like infested logs and firewood and wood products. How far can human assistance spread take Asian longhorn beetle? Around the world, any distance. I'm sorry, Phil. It is scary. So ALB in North America. And this, again, I want to be very specific about. In every case, there's been a single point of introduction from Asia so far. Correct me if I'm wrong, Phil. I think that's still true. Each individual, Chicago, they came from Asia. The New York City, and as far as I know, also the Long Island and New Jersey, all from Asia. Worcester, all from Asia. The Bethel population from Asia. In other words, the Bethel population didn't come from Chicago. It didn't come from Worcester, Massachusetts. And usually what happens, you have a point of introduction, and then usually from there you do get multiple infestations in a region. And the proof was pointed to just a little bit ago. If we look at this, for example, Asian longhorn beetle was first discovered in Brooklyn in 1996. All of these infestations are connected. They are all connected. Thankfully, though, eradication does work, and it has been working there. Chicago discovered these infestations in 1998. Now, all infestations connected to a single point of introduction from Asia, but thankfully, all the Chicago infestations have been eradicated. Now, an infestation is declared eradicated in North America if you have three consecutive years with absolutely no detection of any indication of Asian longhorned beetles. Everybody hear that, what I said? Nothing. There's no indication for 3 years in a row. That's pretty steep when you think about it. And that's not just saying, well, we can find more trees that are infested. That is where good, hard detective looking is going on. Chicago, a good example. You know, people were seriously looking before that was declared eradicated. So closing in. Now, the Worcester, Massachusetts infestation was the scariest one. Maybe even remains scary to this day because it was the largest infestation found thus far. However, even there, and I visited Worcester in 2009 with Jim Chatfield and Eric Draper. You'll see some pictures. We were actually at the ISA conference in Providence, Rhode Island. And on our way back, we just swung up and were able to meet up with some USDA folks that were kind enough to meet with us. They didn't know us. That's why they met with us. And show us around a bit. And a couple things jumped out. First of all, we got to meet with the person that discovered this beetle, was a homeowner, and a very astute homeowner. First of all, she'll tell the story, and there's even a video where you can hear her talk about this directly, where she describes a number of beetles being almost like Japanese beetles. They couldn't have picnics. These were big beetles. There were so many that they just didn't even really feel comfortable being outside. A lot of beetles. Scary. That was in 2008. When we were there in 2009, the number of beetles had dropped down that they were hard to find. So going from that big number down to being hard to find is incredible. So it goes back again to just, yes, this beetle can be eradicated with hard work. So how about ALB in Ohio? How did it get to Ohio? Well, we don't know. We don't know. I mean, some of you have seen this before because I still contend we have some theories. It's in my contract. I have. Just don't open a box that says from Michigan. That's all I'm saying. What we do know is that the population in Ohio is not linked to other populations in North America, that it did come directly from Asia. And how we know that is because of DNA variants. Now, it's very slight variants. It's about the same that's used in paternity tests, and it's based on a very simple, and if you think about it, very simple idea called the founder effect, meaning that not many beetles are usually shipped in at one time, right? Maybe, I mean, theoretically, a population could be started with one male and one female. We're thinking it probably takes a little bit more than that, but not many can be shipped in without being discovered, right? So you start with very few beetles, consequently, all their offspring are going to be very closely related, aren't they? It's going to be like one family. That's the variance that we're talking about. But it's good that we can at least know that, because at least we can know that, no, something wasn't happening untoward from Chicago or from New York or from Worcester, Massachusetts. So we know that it did come directly from Asia. And of course, this is what got the ball rolling. This is why we're here today. June 17th. The discovery was announced. And then a subsequent, remember what I said, okay, so you have the point place, you have the place where it starts, then you might start getting other infestations. The second infestation that was announced on September 9th, again, isn't big, but it was where firewood was moved out of Bethel to the new location in Monroe Township. So this is what it looked like, quarantine on June 17th, quarantine on September 9th. The Monroe Township infestation was based on property boundaries, I believe about 88 contiguous properties. The quarantine with Bethel is based on both geopolitical and road boundaries, so road boundaries, geopolitical. That makes it handy in order to be able to regulate the area. if you have a road that this side is yes and this side is no, then obviously it makes it pretty handy for people that will be able to know which side of the law they're on. And of course, here a couple of weeks ago, in fact, you got the notice, I imagine. Notice how that dot separated. That dot stayed there, then a new dot came from that dot. What am I talking about? Well, July 20th, it was announced that in Stone Lick Township, there was another infestation found. Now, that sounds bad, except there are some details that I actually think sound pretty good. First of all, I don't have, you know, don't have a real nice map yet because it's still being investigated. But this is the approximate location, the core of the Bethel infestation. Stone Lick's up here, and this is the approximate location of the trees. Now, Mark, if I get this wrong, jump in, because this is what I okay, the original find, only two trees, is that was correct, and a third tree with an adult on it. One tree with emergence holes and overposition pits, a second tree with only overposition pits, but the investigation is still being, infestation is still being investigated. That's not big, is it? But here's why it's not big. Landowner removed a dead maple for firewood from Bethel in April 2010. Now, this kind of answers a question right off the bat. You know, sometimes you'll hear people say, well, this doesn't kill maples. Well, obviously, it did. And that maple then was taken to this property, and the landowner, this is good, discovered the infestation after a windstorm dropped an ALB weakened branch. The homeowner in Worcester, Massachusetts, saw these peculiar beetles spoiling her picnics, scaring the neighbors, attacking the kids, well, I'm just big, chasing the dogs, big beetles, and she went online and investigated and found that, in fact, this didn't belong. This landowner was aware enough to say, wait a second, here's a branch coming off of a tree, off of a maple, and it has these galleries. I think that's a bad thing. The branch broke because of ALB being in the xylem, and then that led to the detection. That's not a bad thing, is it? That's the kind of thing that we're hoping happens in the future. So far, this is what it looks like in North America. Little individual dots, not large. Discovered in 1996, more pointedly, USDA APHIS is in the 16th year of battling the beetle, and I'm going to put this a different way, the 16th year of experience. The 16th year of experience. It's been eradicated in Chicago. The corner has turned in Worcester, Massachusetts. It's been eradicated in New Jersey. It's been eradicated in Islip on Long Island. Some of the New York City borough infestations are coming to a close, being monitored to see if they're eradicated. So I'm going to propose something. I think that we've got some people that know what they're doing. What do you think? 16 years, and there have been successes. And I might add something else. And I know Mark won't say this. I know Jonathan back there won't say this. But they also are working with some top-notch people with the Ohio Department of Agriculture, bottom line. Now, this isn't a paid endorsement or anything like that. This is just how I feel based on the observations of things that I've seen. It's why, what did I say a while ago? I'm optimistic. 16 years. Eradication has worked. Early detection is critical. It's why you're here today. We've got good experience, but we got to have more eyes. We got to have more eyes. So some beetle basics, say longhorn beetles, so named because of these long antennae, belong to the family Cerambycidae. Now, we're going to talk about emerald ash borer in just a bit, and emerald ash borer belongs to an entirely different family called Buprestidae. So longhorn beetles, huge beetles, big beetles. I mean, look at the males. Look at the male. There's Eric Draper pulling one down. Of course, based on training, and we've got the guy that was horsing it right here, look at the females. Kevin, you knew I was going to. As soon as I saw you registering, I thought, yeah. That's my hand, and I have pretty big hands, and that's a pretty big beetle. And that happens to be a male. The male has longer antennae than females. And so you can see it is a big beetle. It is a big beetle. And the larvae are very distinctive compared to some other borers. Emerald ash borer, what do the larvae look like? They're called flat-headed borers because they look really flat. They look like miniature tapeworms. This looks like a Michelin man. Look at that. All puffed up, huge. Now you got to be really careful with larval identification. As a matter of fact, if you find a larva in a maple tree that's alive, that's not good. If you find a cerambycid in a live maple tree, that's not good. And it will be sent to the experts, and don't be surprised if it takes a while for identification. Why is that? First of all, larval identification for immature insects is difficult at best. It's almost impossible for some insects, I will tell you that. Because we base the taxonomy on the adults and primarily on the genitalia of the adults, and of course, the immature doesn't have that. So the reason for taking time is because you could find a cerambycid larva in a maple branch that recently died. Why is that? Because we have native cerambycid beetles that we call the cleanup crop. The beetles come in, lay eggs, those eggs hatch, and they will feed on that wood that is dead. So chronology is very important. So I'm not saying that you won't find these, but what I also want to stress is that if you find a cerambycid in a maple and most of that tree is alive, you need to pay attention. And maybe I'll even go further. Don't rule anything out. Everybody hear what I just said? Don't rule anything out. Don't leap to a conclusion that it's not, because investigate. Make sure you find out for sure. And this is another with some what I call nearly look-alikes. These are beetles that, you know, such as white-spotted pine sawyer female. Doesn't really look a lot like an Asian longhorn beetle, but I'd rather see it. Last year, during our 4-H fair, our Hamilton County 4-H fair, a young lady in the 4-H program found this beetle in a watering bowl with, I think she had chickens, and it was in the watering bowl. And she had seen the Asian longhorn beetle display at the fair and decided, well, I'd better take this to the extension folks so they know about it. Now, again, very small but long antennae, and quite honestly, I was very proud of that heads-up response. She didn't just say, well, it doesn't look anything like it. It was saying, wait a second, this has long antennae, longhorn beetle. So again, that's what we want. Cottonwood borer is actually kind of rare in Ohio, black with white markings. If you close your eyes and I said, okay, this beetle is black with white markings. Remember, Asian longhorn beetle is black with white markings. Sometimes people will read without seeing a picture, and you can see, well, they don't look quite alike, but I'd rather see this and rule it out than actually be an Asian longhorn beetle. Eyed click beetle, you might think to yourself, again, it doesn't look anything like it, but it's white with black markings, isn't it? Or black with white markings, is zebra white with black stripes? Or, of course, Asian longhorn beetle. Another name for this beetle in China, one of the Chinese common names, is the starry night beetle. I've always liked that. It really describes it. Looks like somebody's dabbed. Okay, these aren't real distinct white markings. Kind of looks like a frayed paintbrush was used to dab white on. And we really don't have anything else that looks like it. It does have complete metamorphosis, one generation per year. And I want to stress that this is the tree-killing phase of the development. So one generation per year, this is the phase that kills the trees. All stages except the adults can overwinter. That's very important. However, the adults do die after the first substantial freeze, which is a good thing. Very good host for Asian longhorn beetle, all maples. So anything in the Acer genus. Now, and then the horse chestnuts, buckeyes, elms, willows, These are very good hosts, several months ago, as a matter of fact, I was trying to come up with a way to sort of explain, this, very good hosts versus hosts that are a little less preferred, without implying that this beetle doesn't kill all these trees. So very good hosts are like, the maples are like porterhouse steak. These are like T-bone, very good steaks, aren't they? But by golly, if I don't have a steak, I'm still going to eat hamburger. And that's exactly how this is pretty well played out. All of these trees, we would be like hamburger. Pretty much listed in terms of more frequently found, less frequently found. So does everybody catch the drift here? We're talking about 13 genera. We're talking about some total of over 100 species if you get right down to the nitty-gritty. I won't even go into the varieties and cultivars. We're talking a lot of trees. And I want to make no bones about it. If it infests the tree, it can kill the tree. Does everybody hear what I said? This isn't just like, oh, it's just going to kind of land on a catcher and say, oh, nice to meet you. If it will infest, it will kill the tree. Dead maples, this is in Worcester. Dead maples, infested Katsura, infested birches. We'll see pictures of this. This is an infested birch tree, you can see by the emergence hole. Interestingly enough, before Asian longhorned beetle was discovered, somebody pruned that tree and cut right through one of the emergence holes. The point being is there you have birch, there you have Katsura with egg sites. This beetle tends to be pretty indiscriminate where it attacks the tree. With emerald ash borer, as we've all learned, there's a tendency to be top to bottom, outside in. With Asian longhorned beetle, it can be anywhere. You're just as likely to see an overposition pit or a resulting emergence hole at eye level as you are at the top of the tree. It's very, very random. So attacks trees of all sizes from top to bottom. Economic impact, and again, this is probably review for many, but it's good to be on the same page when people, why does it matter? $2.5 billion in standing maple timber alone. I didn't know this till I got involved with all this. I actually did not know Ohio ranks fourth in maple syrup production, just didn't know that. We do know that our nursery industry could have a huge impact. That's the value of the industry. I was going to pick on Bill Lager in there because he's the nurseryman I know. What is the one of the most popular trees grown in nurseries? Maples. I think the last survey was 45%. Is that right, Bill? Or do you remember? I don't know. 45% were Acer. Now, that's not just Ohio, but you lose those trees, that's a big impact. Think of losing all those trees in the landscape, and think about the safety and liability risk to communities and property owners, as we are seeing with the loss of one genus, Fraxinus, right now. Only one genus, and it's pretty devastating with emerald ash borer. Think of passing that over 13. And then think about the cost of dead tree removal. So we're talking about street trees for the city of Cincinnati. So we're talking about trees, between the street and the sidewalk, basically. Okay, so not in the yard, not in the back of the yard, not out in the parks, only between the street and the sidewalk for the city of Cincinnati. If Asian longhorned beetle is allowed to reign, they would lose 21,250 street trees. That's no small numbers, 25% roughly of all the trees they're managing on street trees alone. Loss of keystone species, which means loss of habitat for wildlife, encroachment of some non-native plants, increased stormwater runoff, destabilization of soil, reduced stream quality, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Extension has been working a bit with Metropolitan Sewer District regarding stormwater runoff, mitigating stormwater runoff. Trees and stormwater. Well, it's important in our region because there's the Ohio River, and the desire is to prevent having raw sewage going in the river. Not good. All right, we do know that trees take up water. Through a process called evapotranspiration, we know that it's taken up in through the air, taken up through the tree, transpired, released into the atmosphere. It's part of the water cycle. But just how much water do trees take up? How much is it? How much of an impact? 20-inch diameter breast height maple, 5,384 gallons of stormwater annually. If you want to picture that, that would be a pool about 15 feet wide and about 4.3 feet deep annually. That's a lot of water. 21,000 trees that Dave might lose. Now, I don't know what the average DBH is, Dave, but these are probably not little trees, are they? So you're talking a lot of water that's going to do what now? Not be evapotranspired into the atmosphere. That's an impact. And green grows. Green grows. Look at this. If you want to look this up, it's treebenefits.com calculator. And so if we run this over DBH and gallons taken off, it is a pretty much a linear curve. That's from the Horticulture magazine, duh. Bigger trees take up more water than little trees. If we want to do this, and this is green, if we wanted to do this with pipes, what would you have to do? Bigger pipes. So green grows, and green has an impact. An Asian longhorn beetle can have an effect on that. And how does it do it? How does it kill trees? Remember, it's the larvae, that larval phase of development where the tree killing occurs. I have to thank Dave for that one. That is a nice, powerful mandibles. A little short segue, though. And just a little tree trunk basics. And again, some of you have seen this numerous times, but I still love teaching with it because it's always a reminder of what it is morphologically that we're dealing with here. Cross-section of a tree. Bark. Then this ring of phloem just beneath the bark, then this magical three-cell layer thick ring of cambium, and then the xylem, which another name for the xylem is what? Wood. That's the wood of the tree, provides the structural integrity. Cambial cells divide to become either phloem or xylem. If exposed to oxygen, what do they become? Okay, wound tissue, wound closure tissue, callus tissue. That's not a name, that's an old name. Pretty magical cells, pretty magical cells. Point being is, though, that what we're also very interested in is this ring where we see carbohydrates and sugars being translocated both down and up in the tree. Food flows through phloem. It's a good way to remember that. And then we have for the xylem, aside from structural integrity, water and nutrients flowing up. I used to think that all these rings worked except for the pith in the middle. We used to actually kind of think a large part of the xylem functioned. So it turns out that there's a big division among trees. Ring porous, where you have just the previous year's xylem that's functional, such as with ash trees. However, with maples, we're talking about a little different type of tree, something called a diffuse porous tree, where we have multiple rings at play. Depending on species, even within maples it can vary a little bit, 3, 4, 5 rings at play. More than one ring at play. So with Asian longhorn beetle, but the later instars turn into the xylem. Now I want to be very deliberate at this point, because I have up here, like this is a rule, like the insect says, well, those entomologists are saying this is how I should behave, so there I will behave this way. I have first and second instars feed in the phloem. As a matter of fact, sometimes it's only the first, and sometimes those first go into the xylem very early. You will sometimes see holes in the xylem that are very, very tiny, meaning that larva went in pretty quickly. And sometimes they don't. I'm quite certain some of the third instars hang out here a little bit longer. So this division is not as tight as it might appear. Do you all follow that? Because that's been a point of confusion. It's not that clearly defined. Here's what it looks like in real life. Why what I just said is important is because once that larva hits that xylem, what happens? No, it's not dead. Once it hits the xylem, it's out of reach to our systemic insecticide. This has always been a problem with cerambycids. As a matter of fact, my first introduction was years ago with an entirely different cerambycid on oak, where there was attempt early on with imidacloprid to try to control it, and it just didn't work. You talk to any entomologist that works with cerambycids, they'll tell you the same thing. They are notoriously hard to control. What's the difference between that and emerald ash borer? Where does emerald ash borer feed? In the phloem. Now we're going to delve into a little bit more, but emerald ash borer feeds in the phloem. The phloem carries systemic insecticides very, very well. The xylem just doesn't. Because most of the xylem does what? Support. So once that larva gets into here, is there any possibility for a systemic getting to that larva? And once it's there and it completes its development and comes out, is there any possibility? We say, well, yeah, Joe, it needs to chew through. I want to be very deliberate on this. It needs to chew through that phloem. Insects can chew without feeding. You're going to see the mandibles on an Asian longhorned beetle in just a second. And if you've ever looked at a grasshopper very closely, where are the so-called teeth? Where are the mandibles? Inside the mouth or outside the mouth? Outside. So you have an insect that has the capability of using those mandibles without consuming what they're cutting through. So what does that mean in terms of consuming the phloem and being killed? It might not work. It may, and it may not. It's not as definite. Okay, so eventually, that heavy tunneling causes weakening. Eventually, it will not only cause weakening, it will cause destruction of the tree. It takes a while. These diffuse porous trees can be riddled. Take a look at this tree. Look at the canopy. Doesn't look too bad. Look at the tree. My gosh, it looks like somebody just shot it, just started firing away the gun, doesn't it? Holes all up and down. Huge difference between this and emerald ash borer. So very heavy beetle production on these trees. Very slow mortality. Big point. Driving over here, looking around, easy to see thinning canopies from emerald ash borer. I can tell you that over in the Bethel area, that was the first thing that surprised the heck out of me. You have trees that could be pretty heavily infested and the canopy looks fine. So that's a big difference with these diffuse porous trees and this insect. But what should you be looking for? Look at the ends of the broken branches. Look at these ends of branches. And those branches will break. So let's cover some of these concerns. This was taken in Worcester, Massachusetts. Some of you recognize Eric Draper. And there was our USDA APHIS host. And they're looking at trees that are marked to come down. But why they're standing there is because you just about couldn't go any further because of all the broken branches. This is over in Bethel. Take a look at the top of this maple. That's broken off because of what? Because of Asian longhorned beetle. So safety issues on the ground. Safety issues in a tree, too. Now, they're very experienced climbers over there. And they're very interesting people. And several months ago, we were over, and there were two climbers working, and I asked that question about, how do you go about making sure that you're not roping off, on a branch that is not substantial or has been made unsubstantial because of Asian longhorn beetle, and that is something that they look at very carefully. Unlike, the way we normally approach things, if the branch is green, looks good, you think, well, that's going to be pretty substantial. In this case, a green branch can be riddled. So they do look for emergence holes. It is a safety concern, and you should be aware of that. Detecting Asian longhorn beetle, then. Identifying heavily infested trees. Emergence holes, big woodpecker holes. These are ovipositioned pits. We'll talk about this in just a second. Frass, somebody mentioned, what is frass? It's excrement. It's excrement. And the Asian longhorned beetle excrement looks like excelsior. Now, some of it's not excrement. Some of it, you're going to see a female, for example, making oviposition pit. And so this so-called frass, in her case, is just simply shavings as she's using her mandibles to gouge out down to the xylem. She's not eating, she's just gouging. And of course, the beetles themselves, both the adults and the round-headed borer, larval form, and of course, branch breakage. I really want to stress that. That has become a very important tool for detecting the beetle. Oviposition pits, adult emergence holes. You can see they're very similar in size. Usually the pits are slightly larger, but these holes and pits are on living trunks and branches. That's an important distinction. Now, I have a dime next to a male adult emergence hole, and it's smaller than what the females will make because the males are smaller. So you'll sometimes read that the emergence holes are about the size of a dime. Well, the female emergence holes are slightly bigger, but there is one really good test. You take a number two pencil, and you jam that in a hole, and it goes deep into the tree, or not all of them will, but when you get these holes, that some will go deep into the tree. Why do they go deep into the tree, first of all? Outstanding. Everybody hear that? They're coming out from the xylem. So there's what it looks like, and there's a pencil stuck in there to demonstrate. And notice you have to use an Asian longhorn beetle labeled pencil. So that shows it. Now that you could not do with a phloem feeder, could you? Now, we have this whole group of insects called clear-winged moths, for example. And most of the clear-winged moths are phloem feeders, just like emerald ash borer. So you try to stick a pencil in there at the emergence hole from clear-winged moths, and it just won't go very far in. You'll hear a distinct thunk. This is always amazing. Sometimes you can put the pencils very deep into the tree. And I learned this from the USDA APHIS folks, and they called it the pencil test. I always liked that. Pencil test. Woodpecker damage, and look how deep. Look how big and deep these holes. Emerald ash borer woodpecker damage. Why is it shallower? Outstanding. Phloem feeders, xylem. Phloem, xylem. So they go deeper for those big morsels of meat. I watched this female for about 15 minutes chewing an oviposition pit. Using her mandibles, she'd gouge, come back, and the stuff would fall, gouge, fall. It was really interesting watching. You'd see it right here. Then she turned around and deposited an egg, put a little bit of sticky frass over it, and left to chew another one, presumably, or have a party. I don't know, she's probably tired. Point being is, one egg per one pit, and they only lay 36 on the average in their entire life. So that's good news. I ask about emerald ash borer, kiddingly, because I said, 300 threw that out. Well, it turns out calico scale females can lay over 1,500 eggs. So when you have an insect that can lay this huge number of eggs, what does that do for the population? Explodes. Emerald ash borer lays a lot more eggs than Asian longhorn beetle. Emerald ash borer is a lot less discriminate. Those females, they almost don't even care. They crawl around, they have this little ovipositor. It looks like a little finger, and just, there's an egg. There's an egg. Whoop, there's an egg. I don't care. I'm going to try to just throw it over there. This is a very deliberate insect. So this is one reason why populations of Asian longhorn beetle, thankfully, build slowly, thankfully don't spread quite as fast as emerald ash borer. Different behavior of these different insects. There are the oviposition pits. They can be fairly large, very easy to see. This is a nice shot. I like this one because you can really see where the females have used those mandibles to gouge. Not consume, to gouge, to be able to deposit that egg. And during certain times of the year, particularly late in the summer, start getting some sap flow, you can really see a lot of sap flowing from these. And also in the spring, you can sometimes see sap, my understanding. And here's what it looks like when you take the bark off. Some of you in this room remember this because this was taken during our demonstration. So each one of these is a pit. There is a single egg in that pit. You know, what you're looking at is the bark was pulled off, so you're looking kind of the underneath. And then there is a larva, first instar larva. Now that larva is sitting there saying, well, first probably saying, what the heck happened? You know, the roof blew off. But it was deciding whether it was going to feed along on the phloem, because this is phloem, right? What is it resting on? Xylem. It could turn into the xylem if it chose to. Some do, apparently. Now, both the larval feeding activity and the female oviposition activity will leave behind these shavings that look like excelsior. And I got to tell you, this is really evident. You see it collecting on the forks and branch forks, but also around on the ground. Again, very, very evident. Don't overlook the beetles themselves. That's how the infestation was discovered in Worcester, Massachusetts. And of course, if larvae are found in living trunks or branches on recently cut trunks or branches from this season, not a previous year, then that's something to look at. That's something to look at more closely. Remember I told you, you're going to see the mandibles? Look right there, they are. Now these mandibles are pincer-like, and they'll pinch quite a lot. You might actually utter a word you didn't mean to. Not like I did that, but they pinch pretty hard. It demonstrates what I was saying a minute ago. Look at how these things are shaped like sickles, and they're to the outside of the insect's mouth. The mouth is back up in here. So they can cut without consuming. But they do consume. Many cerambycids actually do this. They will feed on different parts of the tree compared to the larva. The adults do feed on phloem, and they'll take the bark off of twigs, large twigs and small twigs. They'll also, this is very unusual feeding. Now, you're not going to look for this for diagnostics, by the way, because they don't do a lot of feeding. But what feeding that they do, I said that wrong. They do enough feeding to mature their eggs, but since you don't have thousands of beetles per tree, you're not going to see a lot of it. It's not like Japanese beetle feeding. If you have so many, you're going to see. But this is a very unusual. In fact, I know of no other beetle or other insect that's going to produce this very characteristic feeding along the mid-veins. The point is, though, during maturation feeding, some systemic insecticide can be consumed. So unlike emerald ash borer, what's the primary target for insecticide applications for emerald ash borer? The primary target for Asian longhorn beetle is actually the adults. It's not complete, it's not perfect, but that is the primary target. Very different. But the insecticides are not super weapons. Another one that Dave provided back there. Not super weapons. Because they're aliens. Well, it's getting hot in here and I have no coffee either. So insecticides and eradications. Insecticides have been used in ALB eradication programs, but in conjunction with other suppression methods. And if you take a look at these maps, this is Worcester, Massachusetts, and if you take a look, there's the infestation, the core of the infestation, and if you, excuse me, and these are political boundaries. Now these maps are not perfect. This map is actually smaller than this map, so what I've done is, there's the core zone. Does everybody follow this? I pretty well outlined the core zone, and the yellow is where insecticide applications were made. What do you notice? It's the outlying area. They didn't make applications in the core zone. Why do you suppose? Well, the insecticides are a bit problematic. It's not like emerald ash borer where we're not trying to kill every beetle. But also with emerald ash borer, the efficacy is much higher to begin with because we're going after a phloem feeder. We know much more about the insecticides, and we know how it affects the target. It's a bit riskier, so that's why the zone's out here. Now, as a matter of fact, USDA APHIS ALB eradication program did not make applications this season. Now, I want to be very specific. It wasn't a decision based on insecticides as much as many of you know, and you guys know, a higher population was found unexpectedly. Is that right, Phil? Or they found beetles where, in other words, it was decided that let's spend a little more time delimiting, learning the edge of the infestation, and putting the money into that. Is that?
You're asking about Worcester?
Yeah. He said, that's right. I'm going to call you the day before Ohio State plays Michigan and say, are we going to win? Yeah, that's right. That's right. So the money was just simply shifted into, okay, let's delimit and then go back. I don't want to make a big deal out of, you know, they didn't use them because they're not effective or anything like that, except there are some challenges with insecticides in this insect. And the challenges are the extended adult activity, so you have to have an insecticide active for a long period of time. Label limitations, efficacy is uncertain on large trees, size matters. There's been a limited amount of research that can be done on this insect, so there are some challenges. However, I can go to Home Depot, to a Lowe's, to a garden center, and I can buy this bear product, and I can open it up, and I can see on here that it has round-headed, including eucalyptus, longhorn borers, and Asian longhorn beetle. Kind of points something out. It points something out that's very important. This is not intended to be saying that that's an eradication product. Does everybody hear what I just said? Little side note, as an entomologist and as practitioners, do you all know about what the percent efficacy that we look to in order to say an insecticide is effective? Well, the gold standard is about 70%, 70% control. Is 70% good enough for eradication? No. However, 70% is good enough to have it on the label. So it is on the label. I'm not, you know, there's nothing against the law about this, but I want to stress something, and you all pay close attention to this. If a homeowner does the treatment themselves, which they can with that product, or you do the treatment, if the trees are found to be infested, or they become infested, they will be destroyed. Do I need to repeat that? And that is something that sometimes in other areas it was difficult for people to get behind, let's put it that way. Difficult for people to get behind. Worcester, for example, some folks did their own treatment and then the trees were found to be infested. It didn't say whether the insecticide worked or not. It's just the trees were found to be infested and they lost their tree plus the, you know, time and effort and energy and so on and so forth. So weigh that heavily, weigh that very heavily. Another segue then. Now, whether we're talking emerald ash borer or Asian longhorn beetle or any other non-native insect, hemlock woolly adelgid, it pretty much starts out the same way. Starts out with a point of introduction. It got here somehow. Usually we don't have non-natives arriving, you know, by large numbers, very small numbers. And it's like a little fire. Some of you have heard me teach this before. I always did like kind of using that fire analogy. So now you have this large area that's infested. Out ahead of it, just as with a fire with firebrands, you're going to get hot spots. And eventually those hot spots get larger. Eventually the main fire front itself moves forward and you can have very rapid leaps of the population with the infested zone moving out and these transition zone out ahead of it. ALB management, let's first start with recognizing a big difference between ALB and EAB. What do you see that's different? You see very little small individual fires burning. You don't see wholesale conflagrations. And some of those fires have already been put out. So with Asian longhorn beetle, we're not battling, truthfully, even Worcester, Massachusetts, I would contend, is not like the kind of forest fires that we've seen in Detroit and Toledo and in the Chicago area and Fort Wayne, Indiana, and even here, where I'd say we're in an EAB conflagration. So So very, very different. We're looking at tackling the fires at these point source areas of introduction with the idea of eradicating being just like when you manage a fire, if you can catch it early and attack those individual small campfires, keep them under control, put them out before they get out of hand. And that's exactly what the desire and the intent is at Bethel, is to be able to, the fire trucks have arrived, to be able to put that fire out before it becomes a full-fledged conflagration. It can be eradicated. It can be eradicated. With help, though, and once again, I want to go back to the idea that this is a very effective eradication tool, but it can only be applied if the beetles are discovered. And if we take a look, for example, at what has been happening in Bethel, the survey began on July 1st, 2011. As of August 11th, 2012, 160,768 trees have been surveyed. That's a lot of trees. 8,708 trees have been confirmed infested with ALB so far. The survey is continuing. It does kind of look like a little shotgun blast, but as we know, there can be some outliers, and if you look closely, there is that little dot right up in here where you have the more recent find. So, phase one of the eradication has been to remove the confirmed infested trees. 8,708 trees confirmed infested as of August 11th, 8,622 had been removed. I don't know how you feel about it, but I'm sure you must feel the same way I do. I am glad that number is very close to that number, aren't you? And that has been going on and on throughout the winter, throughout the spring. Removal costs are paid for by the ALB eradication project, and the removed trees are chipped to less than an inch in two dimensions. At that size, all life stages are either eliminated or can no longer be supported by the chips. And that also then puts that material as a deregulated article. So this is what it looks like. Trees are marked, taken down, hauled to the marshalling yard, run through a grinder, in fact, sometimes double ground because that's being monitored. Mark will tell you right there. And so here's a pile of chips, and there they are. Less than 1 inch in any two dimensions. I love these maps. It really does show kind of a tracking visually of, okay, June 2011, there's the first detection. There's the first place, ground zero. And if we go to July, okay, here are more detections. Now when you see yellow, that's individual trees. Green means cumulative, means multiple trees in one spot, okay? So now we're starting to see, oh my goodness, there's a lot more September, October, more discoveries. But then something interesting starts happening. This is where phase one starts kicking in. Removal of confirmed infested trees began November 14, 2001. So now you're going to start seeing black dots. And look what happens here. Black dots, black dots. Now, I always get asked this question. Well, wait a second, Joe. Why did they start here and work out? Why not surround them and work in? My understanding is the trees out here, though, are much, much less heavy, much less infested than what was in here. Is that pretty much correct?
Generally.
Actually, I shouldn't have picked on this. Maybe.
A few
exceptions. But the rule is kind of that really heavy, a little less. Now, that doesn't mean, I know why they're being good entomologists, actually, because you never say never. It could be that as it keeps being pushed, I mean, you know, there's a chance. And this is what happened in Worcester, was that a hotter spot than what was originally known was discovered. The next step is going to be based on this environmental assessment that was issued in May 2012. And in there were four alternatives presented where people could comment on which ones that made more sense to them, and actually which ones, based on their comments, that may had higher risks, or just what their thoughts were on it. And the comment period closed on July 9th, 2012, and during that period, over 460 comments were submitted. So people had ideas, people had opinions. That was a good thing. Because the good thing is, August the 7th, Secretary Tom Vilsack announced $14.8 million in funding to help eradicate ALB in Ohio. That was good to see. That was good to see. Because that's telling you, it's telling me that there is federal commitment. Phil's here. There's been commitment with money committed already. That means continued commitment. And that's a good thing. Final segue. Summary of some of the challenges. First of all, let's not forget that this is a tree killer. This is a tree killer that I will submit we have never seen in the United States. So a lot's at stake. Detecting lightly infested trees is a challenge, and we're going to finish with a very quick graphic. Some of you have already seen this, but just kind of a reminder of what are going to be some challenges that we will continue to face. Insecticides are imperfect. It's not the same as with emerald ash borer. Insecticides for ALB, more problematic. More problematic. Not the same. Tree removal and destruction is highly effective for eradication, but devastating for homeowners. And your perspective may depend on where you live. Yes, here's Bethel. Row of maples, look at that, marked, and they've been taken down. But there's Worcester, Massachusetts. This was a tree-lined street. A lot of the stumps are not there because they've been ground out. But when we visited there, a number of homeowners said, you could stand where we're standing, and trees were, it was a beautiful street. So there will be an impact. Identifying lightly infested trees, this is a problem. This is something I was unaware of at the beginning. Because the very first tree that I looked at was right here. It was a so-called golden tree. It was riddled. It was beautiful if you're an entomologist. You don't want me happy in your landscaping. That's a, and so there we are, taking pictures, learning. Over here is Dr. Curtis Young. He has his PhD in entomology. And a few others, there's Nancy Taylor looking up in the tree saying, now wait a second, this is a silver maple, this is a type of red, we couldn't quite figure out the cultivar. We could find nothing on this tree was riddled. The beetles could walk from tree to tree, what was going on? It taught us two things. First of all, this beetle thankfully does tend to spread slowly for the reasons I've already outlined. It also taught us something else, though. After we left, we're looking elsewhere, Curtis stayed, and he finally found, way high in the tree, with the help of some binoculars that somebody had on hand, an oviposition pit. You know, I had this slide for quite some time and hadn't paid a lot of attention to it because I was teaching. Some of you remember that. The very first time we got together, I was thinking, wow, after all this time with emerald ash borer, it had to be the same. Elliot, you had to feel the same way. These little tiny holes, I mean, my gosh. And, you know, the older you got, not Elliot, I'm not saying you, the older you got, the harder, he knew I was going to pick on him eventually, the harder to see. You know, then all of a sudden, here are these giant holes you could stick a pencil in. You could close your eyes and diagnose Asian longhorn beetle, I thought, until this tree showed me otherwise. Yes, easy when it's heavily infested, difficult when it's lightly infested. I mean, cut this tree down, but you decide this tree's not infested when it is. So we have data. There's actually data on that. Very good data, by the way. Positive identification of ALB in lightly infested trees is a challenge. Ground crews, 20 to 40% of lightly infested trees are identified. And then if you go to experienced, some smoke jumpers who've been at this for a long time, up in trees, they at most may only find 75% of lightly infested trees. That's the trained people. You know, you get somebody up there like inexperienced climbers, you know, doing it, and, you know, who knows what you're going to get, right? I mean, I tell you. But we go back to, what does this mean? A little graphic representation. Let's start off with 160 potential ALB host trees. So every tree could be infested because it's either steak or hamburger, okay? But let's say that we discover down here a confirmed infested tree. Let's say that unknown to us, there are actually 100 lightly infested trees scattered about. So let's apply the math. Does everybody catch this? This is a hypothetical, but it's actually probably not too unrealistic when you think about how this insect works. So, not yet surveyed, we go with a ground survey, 20 to 40%, 30% average, and then we say we're only going to remove those trees we've discovered to be infested, so we take out 30 trees. But let's bring in the climbers, the experienced climbers. They're going to have 60 to 75% success, but let's just put it to 70 on the average. And so we're going to remove 70% of what they found. That would be 49 trees. And so that's what it's going to look like. Now what we have left is 21 lightly infested trees. These are infested, but what's worse about it is they are now false negatives because this area has been looked at and not found to be having infested trees when in fact they're there. It's just that they're so lightly infested they haven't been discovered. But that means that as long as they exist, there's a potential for human assistance spread and a source for natural spread. And eventually, they will become known. The last point I really want to cover, let's go back to the host list. And let's bring up this idea of what kind of recommendations should we make in terms of replanting inside and outside the zone. What are your tree selection recommendations? Inside the regulated area, don't plant ALB host trees during eradication. No restrictions, though, after eradication. After it has been declared 3 consecutive years. In other words, if you go to Chicago, you can plant anything. Now, what about outside the regulated area? There is no restrictions. There isn't. I mean, think about it. If we said here in Cincinnati, well, we're not planting maples, what does that say? Well, first of all, it's a declaration that the eradication isn't going to work. I don't feel that way. I don't mean how many of you feel that way, but I'm certainly not going to say it is that dire, because it wasn't that dire in Chicago. They had a much wider spread infestation. It's gone. Secondly, overarching recommendation, don't let pests and disease considerations dominate tree selection decisions. Let's give some examples. All right, if you go outside to oak, let's say, all right, I'm not going to recommend anything that ALB will kill in Cincinnati, so let's recommend oak. What about sudden oak death? Well, hickory is not attacked by Asian longhorned beetle, right? So the index of plant diseases in the United States lists 133 fungi and 10 other causes of diseases on carrier species. If we base tree selection decisions on only avoiding pests and diseases, we would plant artificial grass. That was said by Ben Franklin. Well, all right, okay, you smelled me out. There's my second quote. I kind of pulled you in because here's the downside. Everywhere that Asian longhorned beetle has been found, there's been grown up around it myths and misconceptions. Always consider the source of your information. Sometimes it's just misunderstandings, but these were gleaned from our local media by and large. Little's been learned elsewhere about ALB and eradication doesn't work. I guess what happened in Chicago doesn't matter, right? It's widespread in Southwest Ohio. Do you truly believe that? A couple others pick and choose. Oh, it only infests maples. No need to worry about other hosts. Insecticides are highly effective. They make trees immune. Infested trees are easy to detect. These are myths and misconceptions that have grown up around here. And I don't mean to be harsh, but this is really a conclusion that we might draw from that. There's nothing so absurd that if you repeat it often enough, people will believe it. And finally, what's more dangerous is myths which are believed in tend to become true. This is one of my favorite quotes. Everyone is entitled to their own opinions, but not their own facts. When you work with ALB, always think of just the facts and go from that perspective. These are good sources of information, great sources of information. After the next training segment, I'll bring this back up. But I want to conclude with what ties to your handout regarding being a tree hero. This is a brand new opportunity and a pretty exciting one. In your kit, you have posters, print ads. You also have the ability for web banners and so on. But here's where I want to get to. If you go to beetlebusters.info, Beetlebusters, that's the big time site, USDA APHIS big time site, and you go to partners and you register as a Be a Tree Hero, then there's some really neat benefits that will come your way. If you want to be involved in doing what I've said, to say, all right, I'm going to, in Columbus, do some training on Asian longhorn beetle, do some outreach, well, that will be listed, your event and activity promoted in your community on this website. TCIA, Voice of America, well, your company loco will also be put there. Now, why is this important? Because what's the reason for today's training?
Spread the word.
Spread the word. You spreading the word as well as me. You also becoming educators. Working with your clients, working with your communities. You are professionals, just as I'm a professional, as we all are, in trying to help stop this beetle.